Can you hear me?
Yeah. Hello, everybody. This is Jan Moray and my co-host, Mona Duncan. We've got a couple of other guests today for Greet the Week. And Mona's going to get us started about finding and maintaining balance. So, Mona, what's on your mind?
Right. Well, balance, you know, it really is critical. And we need balance in everything, our balance sheet in our budget and, you know, our balance in our life and balance in our vehicle.
Yes.
So, yeah, we think in pictures. And if we don't get the picture, we don't get the concept quite as easily. And a lot of what we talk about with choice theory and reality therapy is kind of metaphysical. And so as we can get something concrete to look at, we can understand it a little better.
Yeah, that's true.
So in looking at our car, you know, as we just drive it around town and through life, sometimes it is out of alignment. We may have hit a bump or we may have hit a curb or something happens that causes it to become out of alignment. And if that alignment is not rectified, what begins to happen to your vehicle?
You wear out your tires.
Well, you wear out your tires eventually, but what's some of the, you know, that doesn't happen as easily as a couple of other things that's come up front. Does it pull from one side to the other?
Yeah,
it's difficult.
It pulls in one direction. Now, the thing of it is a car is an inanimate object. So if it is out of alignment pulling to the right, it's going to always pull to the right. But we as individuals with our, you know, being, sometimes whenever we get out of alignment, we just fluctuate back and forth. We'll pull to the right and then pull to the left. You know, Jan and I was talking the other day about someone backtracking. And some, you know, whenever we're out of alignment, a lot of times we have a tendency to do that. We'll backtrack, you know, up one day, down the next, or whatever. But we're just out of alignment and not in even keel. And then also, you may have a little wobble whenever you get over a certain point.
Yeah.
Have a car out of you get up past 50 and it was just beginning to shake.
Mm-hmm.
And then also the fact that the tires do wear out prematurely. One side, a portion of it, you know, looks really good, but a portion of it is balding.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is that those things happen with us whenever we mentally, emotionally, physically are not in alignment.
I have a question.
Balance. So here with the thinking about and having some visuals to look at, I have here a rather small glass of water. And so how heavy is this water, this glass of water?
Probably not too heavy. Doesn't look like you're straining.
No straining. But if I sit here our whole several minutes together, will this become heavier?
Yeah.
It'll feel heavier.
It's
not going to get heavier in reality, but it's going to feel heavier.
It's going to feel heavier because I'm holding on to it rather than using what is at hand and what is very needed, you know, nurturing from water, rather than putting it down and then going back to it as I need it and picking it up and putting it down and going back to it as I need it and picking it up. And so to find and maintain balance in our life, we have to realize that sometimes, you know, we can't hold everything at one time because then we become too burdened down and too. So I think back to my daughter and I homeschooled her and she was in the third grade. And we'd been homeschooling for a while and wanting to have academic success. You know, I had this list of what to do and what our lessons were and so forth. And one day she looked at that list and she rubbed her little head and she just held that list kind of out and looked at it and rubbed her little head. And she said out loud to no one in particular, she said, "I don't have any time to just be." And I realized, you know, that was a wake-up call for me, that I didn't have any time to just be either.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I was so involved in so many things and community projects and personal endeavors and homeschooling. And so I made a decision that not only was I going to, you know, give more free time to my daughter, but I was going to take that for myself, that privilege for myself. So I made this a little graphic here for us to look at. Maintaining balance, making time, finding time to just be. Can you see that?
No, you need to share it.
Oh, I'm not sharing?
No, you're not sharing.
Okay. Okay. I have to come back with us and share.
Yes.
And hit that. And share screen.
There we go. It's coming
now
up.
Now can you see it?
It's coming up. There it is. We got it. Time to just be.
Yeah. Yeah, time to just be. Okay. So we want balance, not juggling. Mm. Juggling in and of itself, you know, if we were juggling three or four balls, we'd have to have constant engagement with it. And so juggling, well, it just takes a lot of energy. So balance, you know, and also, you know, Enron, if balance, juggling has a tendency to have a negative connotation to it. You know, Enron juggled the books. But balancing, you know, it's looking at the whole. The whole consists of our physical, mental, emotional, intellectual, social, our whole being. And so I use a three-legged stool, which is of doing, having, and being. And usually if there is one of our legs that is a little off kilter or not quite as in balance, it's usually our being. Our being, our equilibrium, our harmony, our steadiness, being, you know. So I suggest that in our life we have an endless supply of time, an endless supply of resources, of love, of the mystery of life, of what all's going on. But we don't recognize that because we don't use it effectively. We wait until the last minute all too often to make a decision or to prepare for the decisions made. And so my personal observation of is to be effective and efficient. Now, talking about a vehicle. Suppose that we have a vehicle and, you know, it's been out of alignment, but we're getting it back into alignment. And that if that vehicle is effective in that it will get us from point A to point B. But it may not be real efficient in that it's a gas guzzler, burns oil, or it doesn't ride smoothly. And so often that's what happens in our life. We may be effective in that we do accomplish some things, but we're not so efficient in it in that we become overly stressed or burdened or just more ineffective than effective. I also find that, you know, the more we complain about anything, it has a tendency to go hand in hand with how much we mismanage it. And then the thought that whenever I personally feel stressed under all the different value things that we can look at, the crunch of, it's time to reevaluate my priorities, to reevaluate them and look at what's going on. So here I have this little chart, and I'm sure you've seen it, something similar to this before. I give them different headings of stressors, makers, takers, and wasters. But it's looking at, if you look in the can you see the little cursor?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. It looks at important, most important, urgent, not urgent. So it's kind of that. But I like to look at it that we have stressors in our life, crises, problems that arise, and we have to put everything on hold and take care of it immediately. And that right there is kind of like hitting the bump that gets our car out of alignment. It seems urgent and it screams at us. And because we put everything else on hold, it, you know, just kind of adds a weight to us, and it works on you. Well, there are things in our life that we can do to actually make more time, or to at least make it more effective and more productive through planning, through organizing. You know, for every 1 hour that we give to planning, organizing, making sure our tools are sharp, that kind of stuff, we can take up to 4 hours off of the actual execution time. And so it's imperative.
And in some things, if you put a system in place, you can get a whole lot more than that out of it, because then you're not even thinking about it. It just happens automatically.
And you exactly.
have the benefits of it.
Exactly. Putting those systems into place and having them where we just take them on automatic. And so that's why it becomes a time maker. You know, it becomes it begins to take away the stressors of life. And the more we can expand this makers into, I'm acting like I'm taking my marker here and making it large, 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 we can a whole lot eliminate those stressors. You know, the more we check our oil, the more we change our oil, the more we check the belts on the car, that things are running efficiently and effectively, the less often we're going to have a breakdown.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it applies to us relationally and just in everything. And the more we take care of maintenance, not only on our vehicles, but on us personally. Rest, we like that. We look at prevention. And these things begin to work in you in that it gives you more energy to be able to do things. However, there are things in our life that are time takers. They're necessary. They're very important. They're routine, kind of the mundane things of life. You know, it's there things you do and you're not thanked for it.
Yeah.
You know, taking the dog out, feeding the dog, preparing meals, doing clean, you know, mowing the yard, all kinds of the work. Yeah. It's just a thankless job. It would be a real stressor if it isn't done, not only for us, but for others too. But it takes time to do it, but it really is a thankless job. And we always seem to be behind on it. And it doesn't become urgent until the time is running out. And what happens all too often is then we go into, and so here, I'm going to stop sharing so you can see, hopefully you can see my graphic here.
Mm-hmm.
What happens is we do not pay attention to the stress, as we don't pay attention to the time makers in life, that we don't take care of our health until we're on the way to the hospital, you know, either us or a family member, or we don't really take care of those relationships and spend time together and until someone's out the door, or we don't take care of paying those bills until, oh, wait a minute, I can't go to work today because if I do, I'll be charged $35 for a late bill and I've got to go, you know, and so we don't, you know, do the grocery shopping until, no, milk, oh no. Or we don't do all of these things that take time until our life becomes just filled with stress.
Well, these things we're putting off until the last minute, and then the last minute else comes up, so we can't get it done, right?
Right. And what happens is that we take all of those things and we go right down to those time wasters, and it's Calgon, take me away. I mean, I don't care. I'm going to sit here and zombie out in front of this TV and let everything be a-okay, and then, you know, we'll deal with your problem later, or maybe we won't. Maybe that'll just go back up into the... And so it is looking at becoming aware of. And now I want to... Look at them. So what do we do? Can you see that?
Yes.
Am I on the right one?
Yep.
I don't know. Do you want to be on your matrix or on the next one, episode and evaluation?
I don't know. Yeah. Right there. Okay. So we looked at that one and how that we, you know, we can, whenever, without having, not making time to plan and organize and so forth, and be proactive in taking those time takers, and also becoming, you know, more proficient at it, that we just kind of go into the time wasters.
And so, why is fun activity called a time waster?
Thanks for asking that. Because we're so overstressed that it's, you know, it's to take me away. I don't care. I don't care. I'm going fishing. Now, am I saying don't ever go fishing? No. No, 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 no. Am I saying don't ever, you know, play video games? No, 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 no. I'm saying plan it into your life so that it is, so that you're being effective and efficient. So that it is a time for recreating. So it is a time for recreation that is recreating to our whole being, to our wholeness, to mentally, emotionally, physically, relationally.
So what you're saying on here is that you're going to these wasters because you're frustrated and fed up because you're just not getting anything else done. You just need a break to do something.
Well, the thing of it is, if it's just a break, go for it. We all need breaks. But all too often, it's kind of the giving up. Because what we've been doing is being so stressing in the process that it leads to just, you know, giving up and forget this job, forget this relationship, forget this. And a lot of it starts back in looking at being, you know, out of balance with us.
I'm a little confused, particularly since one of the main points of choice theory is one of the psychological needs is fun.
Exactly.
But you're listing it as a waster here. And I think probably we need a little bit more discussion about when is fun a waster and when is it not a waster. And I believe it's important to try to learn how to have fun when you're doing some of the makers at the same time. Is that
Definitely. It's to look at and keep our life more in balance with all of these, rather than having so many stressors as we can begin to, the more we go with the time makers, the relationship builders, the more fun we can have, because everything becomes fun.
Yes. Well, this is where the balance comes in.
That's where the balance comes in.
But I believe that in our lifetimes, and we're all over 60, I guess, or close to it, in our lifetimes, a lot of fun has been kind of buried because we're so concerned about accomplishing something, achieving something, being somebody, doing something important, making a contribution, all of which are good. Oh, please go back.
Well, let's just look at this and see if this will maybe kind of sort of look at some of the questions that you're having. Balance in our life, as in balance with everything, is contingent upon a counterbalance. You know? So whatever the episode is, whatever the problem is, whatever the crisis is, whatever the fun time is, whatever the anything is, it is looking at it, and can we say yes or no? And I need to go back and put a yes on there. Can we say yes or no without undue stress and or without guilt? And so to continually evaluate. The evaluation is the key to keeping us in balance. As we can honestly evaluate ourselves. You know, what is it I'm wanting? What is it I'm needing? What is it I'm lacking? And am I using something else, whether it is a time maker, a stressor, am I using something else that is adding to the problem, or is it really being effective and efficient? Is it energizing me or is it depleting me? And then also look at the fact that balance is counterbalance, you know. Sometimes the biggest stressors in our life is others. And yet, where would we be if we didn't have others?
Yeah. Well, that's, according to Glasser, that's the big stressor for us is relationships. That is at the crux of all of our mental issues, emotional issues.
And so it's being willing to use our support system and realizing I can't do it all myself. I can do a lot. And maybe if it's nothing more than just advice and evaluating, you know, have I been given good advice, but I haven't been willing to listen to it? And realizing that everything we do in any of those situations, there are always choices to be made and there are always trade-offs. Because everything has a trade-off. Everything does. And so balance it out with, you know, my thoughts, attitudes, actions. Evaluate that, you know. And then challenge our own excuses. Whenever our life just becomes, and those stressors just begin, you know, bigger and bigger and bigger, and the fun begins to crimp in and be less and less and less. We need to challenge our own excuses. Well, I don't have time to go to the gym. I don't have time to sit and relax. Well, maybe that's when we need it the most. I don't have time to think it through. The time that we can put ourselves back into balance. And know it's not a waster when it is used effectively, when it is used to keep us in balance. And then also it's moving past the past. It's looking at, you know, it's evaluating how much emotional baggage am I bringing into this situation? How much that's keeping me either revved up and angry and frustrated, or it's keeping me depleted, depressed, giving up, not knowing what to do. And then, you know, meditate or meditate. I go for meditation. Not to say don't ever take an aspirin to help relieve a headache. It is looking at the fact that medicate and meditate both come from root words meaning to heal. And sometimes we do, you know, sometimes we need to pick up more water and do things physically, mentally, emotionally, that will heal us. And to evaluate, you know, how flexible are we being? Because if we break when we bend, we're not too flexible. And how are we helping to keep ourselves in balance? And how can we be that rebel without being rebellious? Being rebel meaning, you know, standing up for your own principles. Oh, wait, I have one more little thing here. So I'll go back to share. The food for thought. I truly, truly believe and I teach that we always have a choice. But I must admit, I do not always act like I have a choice. And sometimes I may not even think that I have a choice. I mean, you know, life can be demanding. People can be demanding. Situations cannot go the way you think they, you know. Well, I don't have a choice in this. But, that big but, the yeah, but, I agree that I might want to disagree. But when I realize, when I get honest with myself, when I get back into balance enough, that I do realize that I do indeed have a choice. If nothing else, then my attitude toward the person, toward the situation, toward me, or my facial expressions, I do have a choice. I begin to calm myself down. And in doing that, I find peace. And I also am in a position to find somewhat of a solution that brings back into balance and keeps into balance. And I was working with a client, which just a couple of weeks ago, And he was talking about an incident at work. Well, it's not really a client, it's an inmate. I work at transitional housing for federal prisoners. And he was talking about being at work, and they had a different supervisor on that particular shift. And the guy that was the new supervisor was very harsh, and anyway, he was getting really angry with that supervisor, and he was just almost to the point of walking out. And then they had a break, and he went to the break, and the other guys was talking about, you know, well, he is the boss, and he's here, and I need this job. And then he used his phone, and he called his girlfriend, and, you know, she was telling him the same thing. Well, you need this job, and get things back in order, and all this. And so as we were talking there, and so I began to ask him a couple of questions to help him self-evaluate. And I'm saying, so this supervisor was different from the other supervisor, and whether it was his tone or whatever, you know, were you frustrated with the way he was presenting the information? And then you started hearing some of the coworkers rationalize, you know, or look at their reasons for staying there and maintaining the employment. And then you talk to your girlfriend and her caring, and you begin to calm down. But I'm hearing you give your boss credit for riling you up. And I'm hearing you giving your coworkers and your girlfriend credit for calming you down. What did you do in those situations? And not only did his thinking begin to change, his physiology changed in that he leaned back in that chair and he said, you're right. I was riling myself up, and I did calm myself down. Mm-hmm. Now, were others instrumental in both? Oh, yeah. But it is only as we honestly self-evaluate and find the truth of the choices that we make and the trade-offs that we give in every choice we make, and realizing, is it effective or ineffective? And how much energy am I using, and is it effective or ineffective? That we can begin to find that balance and live in it.
And I guess sometimes we need help to find that balance, or to bring it to our attention that we're out of kilter.
Right. And be willing to own the fact that I was getting riled up because of. Now, it's not to say they weren't being a jerk. I'm not discounting that. Mm-hmm. And it's also to realize that, you know, well, they didn't calm me down. They were a calming presence. You know, what can you control?
Yeah.
Who can you control? Who is controlling you? What is controlling you?
Yeah.
It comes back down to the fact that there are things that are controlling. And I had a guy one time say, I don't know, Miss Mona. I certainly felt controlled when those marshals was on top of me. I said, now were you controlled or were you restrained? And of course, you know, words, you know, there's nothing wrong with the word control. And yeah, if you grab somebody and keep them down, you know, you're controlling them physically. But I said, let's go to your mindset. Whenever those marshals had you down and you back behind you and all that kind of stuff, did you say, oh, yes, sir, I see the light. I see the error of my way.
No way.
No. Well, then they weren't controlling you. They were constraining you. And it's only when we begin to look at, oh, wait a minute, maybe my own worst enemy.
Mm-hmm.
That we can begin to look at the balancers and what needs to be a co-balancer to it.
Well, that's good food for thought, something to think about. And you know, ask ourselves, is our life in balance? What do we need to do to pull it back together? And how are we responding to everything that's going on around us? And what can we do better? And how can we organize better so that we don't get to that?
Right. Right. And that organization, I mean, you know, everything we do affects everything we do.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's realizing that the way we do one thing is pretty much the way we do everything. That we can learn, just like you can't teach an old dog new trick, or Dr. Glasser says you can, but you need new information.
Right. I mean, our brains are phenomenal, even when we get to be old.
And exactly.
We can still change. We just have to want to do it. And it takes time. We've got to put the new habits into place and keep at it. And pretty soon it becomes a part of us, and we can. I mean, it's an excuse to say that I can't change, I can't do anything differently. But if I really want to, I can figure out a way. We're all smart enough to figure out a way.
I have an acronym for CAND: constant and never ending torture. So I'm stopping myself.
Yes. Yeah. We are torturing ourselves when we, and we're holding ourselves back. Whenever you say that word at first, it's, you don't know what we're saying it because that's our first, it's our reaction. When maybe if we sat back and thought about it a little bit more and tried to think of, well, maybe this can help me out. I'm certainly not going where I want to go now. It's probably time to do something differently. Yeah.
So. Well, the big thing for me is recognizing when my stool, because I would use the analogy of the stool myself, but I would use the word body, mind, and spirit. And when I realize that one of my legs of the stool is shorter than the other two have to work that little bit harder to bring me back into balance, or for me to bring myself back into balance.
Yes.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And that being is part of the spiritual. It's part of the part of the well being.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's the first one I want to always look at whenever that stool is rocky.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Well, we're out of time for now. Mona, thank you for taking us along this journey, and thanks to our guests for joining us today, and for those of you watching the recording, and we'll see you next week.
Thank Mona, can you send me on the PowerPoint? I would be grateful if you would.
Okay,
that would be great.